Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the mailbox for the 6th of July 2012. My name is Total Biscuit, bringing you your daily dose of community interaction, gaming discussion, and all that good stuff. You can email in mailbox@cynicalbrit.com, that's mailbox@cynicalbrit.com, with topics for future shows. The game in the background is once again Blur. We've got a little bit of multiplayer going with some of the guys on Twitter. Turns out I'm level 2, they're level 40. Little bit of an imbalance there, but hey, we'll deal with it. It's still a bit of fun. It's all that really matters. Does it speak, I suppose, to my personality that I'd rather end up in 9th place having screwed over the guy that ends up in 10th than actually end up in 1st? Perhaps it does. This one comes in from Smuff that says, recently an FCC patent has arisen for a new super slim version of the PlayStation 3. While that hasn't been made clear whether or not the new design will actually be made for public consumption at a later date, or if it's just an idea Sony is putting forward, would you say that the fact Sony are putting this forward must obviously state they still have no intention to release or even announce the PlayStation 4 anytime soon? Which would of course hold back graphical fidelity even longer. Or is this merely a reaction to the Wii U's release date getting nearer and nearer? Full stops, please use them in your emails, it is helpful. I'm trying to pace that out, like, there's no full stop where... would the pause go? Oh, well, never mind. What I'm seeing is something of an emerging trend here. It seems to me that Sony and Microsoft are almost hoping that the Wii U has what I would call the Dreamcast problem. Now, the Dreamcast problem is, yes, this system is better than previous systems. There's no real doubt about that, but it sticks itself in a really awkward spot, kind of between generations. There's actually a rather amusing number of comparisons you can do between the Dreamcast and the Wii U. For instance, the Dreamcast came out before the PlayStation 2 and before the Xbox. Quite a bit before them, in fact. And the Wii U is coming out before the PlayStation 4 and before the Xbox 720. Once again, quite a bit. Both of them also had big, bulky controllers with a screen in the middle. But whatever the case, it's just an amusing comparison. It seems to me that Sony and Microsoft are hoping to kind of forge ahead with graphical powerhouses that clearly define the next generation. This is all just a theory, of course, but it is supported by evidence. For instance, a few months ago, Game Industry International ended up having a number of anonymous developers that actually compared the Wii U unfavorably to the PS3 and the Xbox 360. While it does have some good points, the Wii U just can't even keep up with the current generation, let alone the next generation. It doesn't have as many shaders, for instance, was a claim from one anonymous developer. The question is that actually true? That is a difficult thing to say, certainly. There's also the obvious limitation that you can only have one of the tablet controllers. Not everyone's going to be using one of these things. The machine is only capable of kicking the screen to one of them. So the standard controllers come back into play. You've got your Wiimote and Nunchuk, which is limiting, needless to say. And then you have your Pro controller, which is essentially a 360 controller, with the sticks being the other way around. There are a few more interesting comparisons. The fact that the innovation of the Wii U is sort of being undermined by Sony and the PlayStation 3 and the PS Vita, because you can do everything you can do with the tablet controller using that, and it's also a legitimate, powerful handheld console in its own right. Now, of course, it's not cost-effective by any stretch of the imagination. You're not going to be paying anywhere near as much for this tablet controller as you would be for a PlayStation Vita and a PlayStation 3, but at the end of the day, the technology is already there. So it's not as innovative as it first seems. It's not like Nintendo is ahead of the pack in terms of something brand new that's going to completely change the dynamic of gaming. Now, I really don't think that Sony and Microsoft actually care that they're holding back the graphical power of gaming and the evolution of fidelity. I don't think they give a damn. Right now, both Microsoft and Sony are sitting in fairly comfortable places with a very large installed user base and consoles they can actually sell for a profit. A lot of platform exclusivity is a thing of the past. Most of this stuff is coming out on both machines. And let's be really honest here, research and development for a new console is pretty damn expensive, and if you screw it up, then you are in a position to take a massive loss. I don't think that either of these guys are in any hurry to release anything, especially since the Wii U doesn't look to be that much of a threat. It would make more sense, I feel, for them to just wait another year, then get their machines out, blow Wii U out of the water in terms of its graphical fidelity, and firmly label it as a stopgap measure between generations. And honestly, their accusation wouldn't be that unfounded. I mean, look at the games lineup for launch for Wii U. A lot of it is existing titles, and that is supposed to say, well, the Wii U now caters to the hardcore crowd. The hardcore crowd already played those games. Most of those games are going to be over a year old by the time the Wii U actually comes out. And honestly, they don't look any better than what they do on the 360 and PlayStation 3. They certainly don't look any better than a PC. So I don't really see how they're managing to grab the hardcore crowd with a bunch of older third-party titles. I don't think that's going to work out at all. It's not that I don't like the look of the Wii U. I think there's all sorts of interesting possibilities with this whole asymmetrical gaming idea. But for a hardcore console, I'm looking for the best. I'm looking for the most powerful with the games that actually suit me. And I'm not really convinced that the Wii U is going to have that. Danger for Nintendo is that if they're trying to appeal to everyone this time around, which they are, they're aiming a lot of stuff at core gamers. The thing about core gamers is they like to have the latest and greatest and the most powerful and the highest fidelity too. And it seems like the Wii U isn't going to be able to provide that for them. So as soon as the PlayStation 4 or 720 end up coming out, then the Wii U is going to be left in third place. I just don't see any other way around that for core gamers. And once again, we have the same problem that we had with the Nintendo Wii, that the games that sell are for more casual or indeed non-gamers. You sell fitness games, you sell dancing games, you sell mini game collections like Carnival Games and Wii Sports, and you don't sell your really good core titles, and they suffer as a direct result. And that's terrible, because the Wii had some great games and they just didn't sell very well, because people didn't buy core games that weren't first-party Nintendo products for the Wii. It seems to me that third-party developers are going to be pretty damn wary. It's like, well, we can port our existing games to this system, no problem, but when it comes to making original third-party IP, we're going to be a little bit careful, especially if we're aiming at the core gamer demographic. Once the other systems come out, I just don't see a lot of companies doing that, considering the number of games that flat out failed on the Wii as a result of the same damn problem. I think, honestly, Microsoft and Sony could just continue to sit on their asses and rake in the royalty money from existing titles on their existing machines that have a hell of a lot of an installed user base, and their user base is growing on a daily basis. Why not just continue to do that and quietly R&D your machine? And once you know more about the competition, then you can develop a machine that just blows it out of the water. There is, of course, a disturbing alternative. The disturbing alternative is that this machine that Sony and Microsoft are coming up with is not going to be as powerful as we would expect. The gap isn't going to be as big. Why am I suggesting that? Because it turns out the Kinect and the Move sold a hell of a lot of units. And indeed, Kinect games continue to sell an awful lot. None of them are core games. Good luck finding a good Kinect game if you happen to be a core gamer. Steel Battalion certainly won't give you that. In fact, it'll give you quite the opposite, a massive bloody migraine. The only one that I can think of, in fact, there's two that I can think of that I would like to play on a Kinect, would be Gunstringer and Child of Eden. And that's it. There's nothing else that uses Kinect that I could give a toss about, honestly. So I don't know what they're thinking. I really hope they're not going down that route. I really, really hope. Okay, fine. Make your movement-based controllers. I admit it, I have a Move, and it's good for some games. It's actually pretty good for FPS. I'm okay with that, and I'd like to see a couple more sword fighting games. The Sports Champions Gladiator game was hilarious. But I don't want my core gaming experience replaced by waggle mechanics, and I certainly don't want a drop in fidelity in the next generation, because once again, it holds the bloody PC back. Means we get these lousy ports and companies have to work harder in order to make the PC version look better, and most of them won't even bother. This one comes in from Oscar that says, ever since Call of Duty 4, the modern military setting has been dominant in the realistic subgenre of FPS, but lately it seems like there's a growing trend of games set in the near future, for instance Blacklight Retribution and the soon-released Black Ops 2. While the setting's been around once in a while, with titles like Battlefield 2142, it never really caught on. The COD series brought an end to the World War II setting, and it is within its abilities, I think, to put an end to this one. Do you think this could happen, or will the modern setting still reign supreme? Well, this thing's kind of cyclical, honestly. What we saw was a big glut of World War II games, and then a big glut of modern games, and now we will most likely see a big glut of near-future stuff, and I'm not the only one that thinks so. The general manager of DICE, Carl Magnus Trodsen, for instance, he speculated on this particular matter, and he said that we're probably going to see people move away from the modern setting because every now and again, settings or themes start to get stale, and then everyone jumps over. Makes sense, really, when you think about it. What essentially happens is that a shooter will grab onto a theme that's popular at the time, milk the hell out of it until everyone can't be arsed, and then moves on to a different one. And most likely, what we're going to see is a move back to World War II shooters at some point in the next few years. Why? Because there are only so many eras you can really go for. You could go for the complete fantasy setting one, in that it's usually an unrealistic sci-fi shooter. But it seems like the near future setting is going to be the current hot topic for shooters maybe over the next year. Why? Because you can relate to it. You can definitely see what's going on. It's not a complete departure from the norm, but it's a sufficient departure for people to actually be interested. Far-flung future FPS has been a genre that never really died, but aside from Halo, has never been astonishingly popular. People will make a sci-fi FPS every now and again, and it might do okay, it might not do okay. If it's Halo, it'll definitely do okay. But aside from that, you've got to think what other games are really in the FPS genre, and don't say Gears of War, because I will slap you. Not a first-person shooter. What I have to wonder is, where do they go from there? Is it just a cycle? We go back to World War II and then back to modern day over the next 3 to 5 years? Or will there be another possibility? Well, unless sci-fi shooters really become big again, that is outside of the obvious example of Halo, then we aren't really going to be seeing that be the most popular thing. And eras in history for shooters, well, that kind of narrows it down, doesn't it? Most gamers don't really want to play Civil War era stuff where they have to reload their gun after every shot. Most people don't want to be musketeers in a line. Most people don't want to be stuck in a trench for 4 days before then going over the top and dying in 15 seconds to a hail of machine gun fire. There are only certain eras that actually support the current model of first-person shooter. So what we need to see is a paradigm shift in the way that first-person shooters are actually designed. What we need is a departure from the Rambo style. And you might say, oh, well, modern military shooters don't do the Rambo style. Yes, they do. They really, really do. You are killing hundreds, if not thousands, of enemies throughout the campaign. That is horrifically unrealistic, and it very much limits the eras that you can put your game into. Why? Because you need automatic weapons. You can't do an FPS where you kill thousands of people if you don't have automatic weapons. That limits you to World War II, Vietnam, Korean War, modern day setting, near future, and sci-fi, essentially. That's all you've got. So how do you move away from that? Well, it's very difficult, but the first thing you've got to do is make the player accept that they are not John Rambo. They can't slaughter hundreds of people on their own. That is silly. Very silly. So how do you end up moving away from that? Well, there's the possibility of large-scale battles where you're able to jump into different characters within the battle. It would make sense, to some degree, to be able to do that. It hasn't really been done all that much, but I would like to point out games like, say, Mount & Blade, whereby you are certainly more powerful than a lot of guys in the battlefield, but you can die very, very easily. Now, the problem is that dying is a failure state for the majority of modern FPS. If you die, you lose the game. So by that logic, you then have to change the failure state. How do you do that? Well, you could have it so that once a soldier dies, he's dead, and you are essentially the army or parts of the army. You are not a single person. The narrative is not surrounding a single person or small group. It is surrounding an entire army, or indeed the progress of nations. And you are taking part in that story. The story is developing around you, and your performance can certainly affect it. But you are not an integral part to it. Would players accept that? Probably not. I think that games have been conditioning players over the last 30 years to believe that they are the hero, and without them, there is no possibility of success. That is what the failure state does. It immediately ends the game if you die. You lose the game, you have to start again. There is no situation that the game can consider in which the story could continue without you. That needs to be moved away from if we want to see more settings, because then you can go further back in time and you can have stuff like World War I, you can have stuff like the Napoleonic War, you can have all sorts of different eras of time because you don't have automatic weapons and you're not John Rambo, and yes, you will die, and it's okay for that to happen. But how do you do that? Because it is a massive design challenge, without question. In Mount & Blade, when you die, you get dragged away from the battlefield if you have enough soldiers remaining, or you get knocked out and taken prisoner. You never die in Mount & Blade, but bullets have a tendency of being a little bit more lethal than being hit on the head with a club, so that's a very difficult thing to do as well. You have to essentially do a bit of an unrealistic and silly contrivance in order to get to that state. I would certainly like to see more of it. Funnily enough, there is a game that is leading the way in that regard, and it's actually Black Ops 2. there are missions within Black Ops 2 whereby you do control an army and you jump into different characters and different war machines. And once you lose that war machine, it's gone for good, or that character and soldier, it's gone for good, and you have to win based on the number of troops that you still have remaining. That's not so much story-driven. Yeah, of course, there's a story justification for it, but you're kind of playing a hybrid between a commander and a frontline trooper. I would certainly like to see more of that. It's definitely not the first game to have done it by any stretch of the imagination. Games like Battlezone did that, and Battlezone is quite old. Battlezone and Battlezone 2 Combat Commander, both absolutely fantastic games for the PC. They allowed you to construct bases from a first-person perspective and jump into any vehicle. In Battlezone 2, you could jump out of your vehicle and actually run around as a foot trooper, although I wouldn't exactly recommend that. That was another example where having your vehicle blown up wasn't necessarily the end of things. It's an interesting design challenge, and if we don't get over this idea of the John Rambo style, then we will be inherently limited in terms of the eras of time that we can create an FPS. Alright folks, that's me done for the day. Thank you very much for watching The Mailbox. That's also me done for the week. A quick reminder, please do go and vote in King of the Web on a daily basis. It's very much appreciated. Doesn't really matter who you vote for per se, but this time around we are supporting Rosanna Pansino, who you may have seen in various videos with Husky, has her own channel, and does a variety of gaming-related bakery things, which is intriguing to say the least. Whatever the case, we're building up votes for the Battle Royale, which is coming very, very shortly indeed. There's $50,000 on the line that we'll be giving to charity if we win. In fact, it doesn't matter where we come, whatever money we're getting, we're giving to charity nonetheless. So you build up your bonus votes, and then we spend them all during the Battle Royale. We've got a good chance of picking up that 50 grand for charity water. That would be absolutely fantastic. So thanks very much for your support, and I'll see you next time.